Okay, so here are the rules. They're pretty simple. I'm going to give you a picture and you can look at it, but then kind of hold it against your chest. And you can talk about it. You can keep re-peeking at it to describe it to people. You just can't actually show it to anybody. And then essentially what this is a book. I ripped out all of the pages, which was terribly painful for me as a book person. But I did it anyway. I ripped out all the pages. So I'm going to give you each one of them. And then your task to kind of warm us up here this morning is just to put yourselves in order. And I'm not going to give a lot more, many more details than that. But just put yourselves in order. Sound good? Okay. And why don't we do page one or right here, and then you can kind of go around. Explain the page. You can ask questions. You can talk us together. You just can't show your picture to everyone else. Okay, so you can go ahead and take a seat.
Whoever is tallest or anything.
Wow. Okay, so was anybody observing what you were all doing when you were putting yourselves in order?
Sorting?
Yeah. You were sorting,
finding common themes.
You were finding commonalities with each other. You kind of started off by separating into micro teams. You said, okay, the boat people over here, the beach people over here. And then you started kind of finding commonalities between the teams. I also saw some interesting activity where one or two people would emerge and say, wait, I think this is what's happening.
Yeah.
And everyone would get quiet and listen to that person. And then someone else would say, wait, I think this is happening. And so there was some interesting leadership emerging in different places for different reasons, just based on ideas of who thought maybe they knew what was going on with the order of the book. So I think some of these ideas about who we listen to when we're trying to solve a problem together, and how you work together, how you divide into teams, how you come together across teams, are some themes that we're going to be talking about across the sessions today and tomorrow. So we will come back to this a little bit and debrief and make some more ties. But good job, you did that pretty quickly. So I'm impressed.
Can you just explain what the Google online would get me to us?
Yes, so we had a book, it's called Zoom, and I ripped out all the pages, very sadly, and we gave a page to every person in here without looking at them. We had everybody put themselves in order. It's just pictures, no words, no page numbers, so it required everybody to work together and decide how to resolve this problem together. Thanks, good job.
Thank you, Sarah. All right, so with that, we're gonna transition into the content of the session today. And as Sarah mentioned, we're going to be talking a bit about who has influence on a team or in a group, who has power on a team or in a group. And that's what Powertilt is all about. Up on the slide here is the NCWIT mission, which alludes to meaningful participation and influential participation. And this is just up here as a reminder that it's important that we understand what people are doing, not just the fact that they are there, but are they able to contribute? And Ms. Oluo talked about this as well, that it's not just being in the space but shaping the space. It's important for us to be able to have influence when we're in our teams and in our workplaces. So how's this gonna work? All right, today we're going to talk about power and influence and why this matters, what is the current state of affairs, why things are this way, and then what we can do about it. In session two, which will be tomorrow morning, we're going to get the results of the Powertilt survey. You all are gonna take the Powertilt survey at the very end of today, and it is a little bit different than how you would use it in your workplace because it's designed to look at how teams operate. You'll understand more later, but just as a preview, it's designed for teams. But what we're going to do today is we're all going to take it. And then what we will do is you'll be able to see how your colleagues here in this room and on the Zoom have answered. And that will give you a sense of how other people are experiencing the teams that they are on. So each one of you will answer for your own team, and it'll be more comparative than just like if a single team did it and you'd see how that team operates. It'll be more like, how does my team compare to the other teams that people are on in this room and on Zoom? And then tomorrow, we're also gonna talk about what perpetuates these power tilts. And finally, we're going to make a plan. We're gonna talk about how we re-tip the tilt. And I'm gonna make you say that 10 times fast. And we'll make a plan that we can take back to our organization. So let's start off by talking about why this matters. And please feel free to ask questions. Like, let's be interactive. It doesn't have to be a lecture. Nobody likes lectures. All right. So why does influential participation matter? It matters for individuals, teams, and society. So when you think about individuals, we can think about how they experience increased employee engagement and they have more job satisfaction. When you have the opportunity to influence your work and the products that you're making, you also feel more connected to the work that you're on, the team that you're on, and you have more opportunities for growth. The more opportunity you have to influence, the more opportunity you receive to be in an influential position. And we'll talk about that more in depth later as well. This is important because this is a stat you may know, but women leave corporate tech workspaces at twice the rate of men. And it is not because they're going to have babies and they want to take care of them, even though that's what you will be told. 80% of these women who leave the workforce or leave the technical workforce stay in the workforce full time. They just leave that corporate technical job. They go somewhere else. They go to government, they go to nonprofit, they go to non-technical work. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Emily. I just was wondering, when you said corporate tech, I was wondering if you could just sort of say what you mean. Does that mean like as opposed to startups or does it mean?
It means technical workplaces that are not government, that are not nonprofit. So it's corporate, that could be big, could be small.
Okay.
Could be startup, yeah. All right, so this matters also for our teams and for our businesses. What we know from research is that teams who have people who have influential participation, so teams that are able to engage their entire team, perform better. They have higher patenting and innovation rates. They have better financial performance. Their teams have better dynamics. They're more productive. They stay on time and under budget better. Employees perform better. More qualified employee pools because they reach into larger groups of people to look for employees, and they have better connections with their customers as well. So all of this thought about how do we bring everyone's voice to the table on the team, it benefits our teams and our workplaces as well. And you don't have to write it all down. You can have these slides later. I will save your cramped hands. Okay, and so some statistics about that as well is that companies with inclusive cultures are ranked 75% higher on best places to work metrics. And non-inclusive environments have an opposite effect and they can be detrimental. I don't have the stat in front of me here, but there was a recent study done where they asked people about reasons to stay or reasons to leave. And people actually said that they would still leave a company where they got a raise if it was a toxic culture. So the culture was more important than the fact that they were going to be offered a raise. They would still leave. All right, this is also important for society. There is better innovation, as we talked about, and this impacts society because of the products that get created, the solutions and systems that get created by our teams. And one example of this is if you look at bias that can manifest in artificial intelligence, which is, of course, everywhere now and getting more and more everywhere all the time. So we put a couple examples up here on the slide, some you may be familiar with already. But three examples are racism in healthcare. In 2019, researchers found that there was an algorithm that was being used by US hospitals to predict who would need more healthcare. So what that means is they were predicting who was going to need additional medical care to decide whether or not to intervene and give them more care proactively. And the algorithm was using previous spending on healthcare. So that was disadvantaging the Black patients because they had spent less previously, not because they were healthier, but because they had less to spend. So they had to go in and realize that this algorithm was causing problems, and they did that. The next example here is depicting CEOs as male. While women, CEOs as male, sorry, my mouth is like not catching up with my brain at the moment. So women make up 27% of the CEOs in the United States, but in 2015, Google's search algorithm would only show 11% of the image results as women. They also did fix this. Part of the reason that this happened, Google came forward and said, is that companies were able to pay for search results. And so it was targeting male pictures, and they were able to say, okay, I want this result to come up when you do a search. And they also backed out of that sort of pay for search results algorithm, which helped us a lot too. And you can also see here that the advertising system was displaying high pay positions to male searchers more than female searchers. Again, something that they did fix. The third example here is about credit limits. And this example is really horrifying. I had not heard this example when I started doing research on this, but it's quite horrifying. In 2019, there's a post from David Hennemeyer Hansen, and he got a credit limit from this Apple Card application that was 20 times higher than his wife. They have joint tax returns. They live together. 20 times more credit for him because he's male. Same thing happened to Apple's co-founder, Steve Wozniak. His wife was only given a credit limit that was 10% of his. Same financial status, male and female difference. So it's important when we think about the impacts that the code has that we write, the products we create on society. We also know that groups with greater diversity solve problems better and faster. This is some research that was done by Scott Page, and it shows that the teams who have diverse people on them will do better with the same problem as a homogenous group, but you have to have activated that diversity. You have to have found a way on your team to bring the diverse voices to the table. Again, this is about who has power, who has influence on that team, who speaks, who gets listened to. All of those things are an important part of making sure that you create a team that activates all the people who are on it. It can't just include people that sit there quietly and don't get to bring their full selves to the product discussion. But this is not the case today. There is a lot of evidence out there that suggests that even when present in an organization, underrepresented populations face difficulty getting access to the roles that are going to give them the power and the influence on the products that are getting created in their organization. Here's a quote that says, "A lot of the times they want our physical presence, but not our voice." So that's exactly what we're talking about. We can't just count people. We can't say, okay, we've done what we needed to do because I counted the people and the numbers are correct. That's not enough. It's not going to get us where we need to go. All right, so we're going to move in now to talk about the current state of affairs.
Sarah? Right. So, yeah, I mean, we've seen all of these reasons why it would be very helpful and important for us to create spaces where everybody can have influence. But as I'm sure you know, we're not quite there. So one way of looking at what is kind of happening currently in many occupations, but especially in tech, computer science, engineering, and other kind of STEM careers, is what we call occupational segregation. So this is happening vertically. I mean, essentially, occupational segregation is when there is inequality and difference that you can see. And those differences have impacts on salaries. You know, that's really where the rubber hits the road, is that this is impacting people's economic success, their ability to get promoted, their financial viability. And it's happening in a couple of ways. So first, it's happening what you could call vertical occupational segregation. So you see some people clustering in certain jobs. Now, that in and of itself might not be problematic, except that the clustering is happening along gender and race lines and other aspects of social identity. So you have what some researchers have called pink ghettos, where there's just all women in certain careers. And you might even say, okay, what about like elementary school teachers? Or what about nurses, where there tend to be, you know, predominantly women? But if you zoom in, even if we zoom in into tech fields, you can see it in very specific subfields. So it's happening across occupations, it's happening within occupations as you zoom in further and further to see the subfields. And again, subfields that are dominated by women or people of color tend to be compensated less. And further, if you see sometimes over time, occupations change as far as who's taking them up the most, right? The term secretary used to be a clerk and it was dominated by white men. Now that's not the case for that occupation. As occupations tend to become dominated by minoritized groups, you see the salaries drop, compensation drops, and prestige drops as well. So it's not necessarily, again, you can't add people and mix it up and all of a sudden it's resolved. Because if you see people in groups, then you see money coming down, salaries going down, prestige going down, and it's not ever coming back up to be an equitable space. So you also see this occupational segregation happening vertically by rank. So even if you pick one very specific occupation or sub-occupation, if you look across rank, you're going to see people, again, women and people of color at the lower ranks, again, with subsequent lower salaries, less prestige, less opportunity for promotion, and then only very certain few people who are holding the power at the top ranks of occupations. And this happens across all occupations. So when we think about this, it's developed, this the segregation is developed over time from repeated subtle messages about fit. You've heard people talk, well, it's just not quite a fit for our team. That's kind of a code for here's who we think belongs at this particular table. So fit and belonging are reinforced in everyday communication. So talk about the way people, teenagers, my daughter right now is talking to me about what kind of job she might fit her. And I, you know, the hairs on the back of my neck stand up a little bit and I think, wow, okay. And all of a sudden she thinks it might not be biology. Last year she wanted to be a biologist. This year she's not really sure because she's not doing well. And her biology teacher said, well, maybe it's not the best fit. Yeah, but yes, that's what's happening. Okay, so if we look in academia, this is just some statistics that you can kind of get a lay of the landscape right now. White women are making up about 7% of bachelor degrees in STEM. Asian women making up about 4% of bachelor degrees. Black women making up about 2%. Hispanic women also 2%. And American Indian women making up 0.07%. Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islanders 0.02%. So pretty shocking statistics.
And STEM?
Or I think it's computing.
Yes. Oh, this is a computer.
Yes,
so pretty small. And this is, again, just for representation, just looking at numbers, not looking at influence, but just who is getting, who are attaining the degrees. Thinking a little bit now about influence, these are some statistics for ACM award data for faculty. So take a look at some of the major awards, and you can see the percent in this red box here, the percent that have been won by women over time. I think this is like over the last 16 years.
What was ACM?
Association for Computing Machinery. Yep.
And from what I understand, that's one of the like most prestigious awards. One of the most prestigious awards that somebody, a faculty in computing could earn. And you can see like over 25 years, only 13% of these awards have been earned by women. So evidence suggests that women lack access to power overall and influence in academia. One way, another metric to look at influence is publishing, right? So certainly awards, whose research is getting recognized, but also where are they publishing? And it turns out that women are tending to publish more in fields that are that have a little bit less influence. So things like human-related computing, management and measurement was the other one. Also documentation. So a little bit less than some of the other fields where you see men kind of dominating the publishing spheres and journals are looking more at computer vision, algorithms, performance, and innovation, which again, those papers tend to be, and those papers coming from those journals tend to be winning more awards and they're cited more often. So again, thinking about influence, it's very different depending on the subfield and the journal and, you know, then the correlated awards and accolades to go with that research. So this is happening in industry as well. And if you look at the stats, you can see for the computing workforce, white women are making up about 16%. Asian women are making up about 7%. Black women, 3%. Hispanic women, 2%. And there are no statistics. Like, it's not significantly recognized for how many American Indian women are in the computing workforce. Which, if this isn't shocking and causing a call to pause for a moment, I am very concerned, not even as statistically significant. Also happening in terms of influence. So it's not just happening in terms of representation, but also an influence. So one way you can look at influence in industry is by patenting rates. And you can see again over time, which kinds of people in organizations are getting those patents, so innovation patents. And over here you can see it's like 74% to 84.5% are men who are getting those patents. And this on the right are men only teams. So not getting a lot of diversity. Even if there are women represented in the organization, the influence is not translating in ways that are considered meaningful participation.
Sarah, can I just point out real quick?
Yeah.
Look at that women only column.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, it's just really strange. It's close in tech. How many nowadays we do see women?
These are patent data, right? So that's a very specific function is, are you able to be on a team that is inventing things such that you can get a patent? And the answer is no.
Okay. And is what you come up with considered worth patenting.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a somewhat sad story, sort of more mine. When I worked a long time ago, when I was still working in tech, one of my colleagues and I, who's female, we came up with, this was in 1999, about. We came up with the idea, we worked for Media One, which is a cable company, that we thought that it would be great if people could store their calendars and their address books in the head end, because then they could access their calendars or their address books from both work and home, because it'd be in the head end. Because of course it wasn't, there was no cloud storage at that time. And we wrote up the whole basis for what we wanted to file was a patent for cloud, there was no cloud, head-end based storage of calendars and address books. And we submitted it to the Media One legal team and it never even got submitted as patent. So I could have held the patent for cloud-based storage, I'm just saying. But it never got submitted because it wasn't considered patentable. Yeah. Anyway, carry on.
No, thank you for sharing. And I'm glad you stopped us to look at the women-only column because again, 1.9% in robotics. Patents are by women-only teams.
Do you also have statistics on how many patents are submitted women-only versus men-only and then how many women actually get patents?
Oh, submission rates?
Yeah, I
don't have them here, but that would be interesting to look up in the patent report.
Yeah,
we should see if that's in there. So there is a patent, full patenting report on our website that you can look up that it was just updated in 2021, last year, that has statistics. It might have that in there, but I don't know. We'd have to look.
Women are submitting less, it could be such a good point. I mean, semiconductor industry, so I see very good.
Yeah,
so I would say that yeah, it makes sense that only 2.2 versus 84.5 are actually getting very disciplined. But I think we would see these to see how many of the factories.
Yeah, right. Great question.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and especially because we know that problem solutions coming from mixed teams and teams with diverse thought are much better than homogenous groups submitting patents. And so this should be even more shocking when we see that, you know, we've got homogenous teams doing the majority of the innovation patenting. Yeah.
So I'm wondering what the education is about patents. right? And so as a first generation person, my initial job was really easy to go last. And I hadn't even heard of tech. And they and somebody mentioned, oh, you should get that, you know, and then I ended up leaving before I packed it. I'm like, dang, now that I know that it is, I should have done it. But I was first generation, I didn't, you know, you don't know. So in what ways is education playing part of this way?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's interesting that you ask that question because we've been having conversations within NCWIT about how you share with more students what patenting means. Because a lot of people don't learn about it until they're into their career. We tried to pitch a funder to convince them to let us create a like entrepreneurship curriculum for the aspirations in computing community to help them understand patenting and potential and doing things like that. It didn't end up working out, but we would love to think about how you make sure that students at all points along their educational journey have the ability to understand what the opportunities are. People don't even know.
I would say that Team Boulder, they have venture partners, and I'm going to be a lot of venture partners, and they offer a lot of educational opportunities. Maybe people don't and see we can partner.
Oh, that's a good idea.
And leverage that. At least start with
that. Yeah. That's a great idea. Thank you.
I mean, I think that tracks also with the academic side of things. I mean, I came from academia very recently, and I did not know the journal ranking mattered in terms of citations and getting tenure and all of those aspects of my career. I mean, it was really just once I started, I was kind of trying to learn all of this, but that wasn't a part of my graduate education. When it could be kind of socializing us to understand what the deeper meaning might be and some of these, like they might seem like innocuous metrics, but they're not. They absolutely matter in terms of promotion, salary, rank, et cetera, et cetera. So we're curious to see if this is resonating with your own experience. So have you seen these patterns in your jobs?
Yeah. We both work for the same company and those statistics really resonated because our company is very big on pushing patents and supporting employees actually submit patents. And you weren't sitting here and thinking about it. Like, like most of the people on that list I've seen are men. So we're already like starting to brainstorm, bringing this information back and making it more accessible to the company. But it's definitely, I feel like education, I think men think they know that they were taught growing up that they can just like,
oh, it's practicing.
Exactly. Yes. I mean, they know like I didn't know until the past year that like that's something that anyone can do. It doesn't have to be an invention, it can be a process. So it, like attacking your ideas, definitely, as you're talking about with education, on like every level, like teaching at a university level, and you can't sooner because you don't need a degree to submit it. But it's definitely, I think definitely that like cultural, like gender difference of, you know.
Right, my idea is good enough to patent, to put it forward for patenting, yeah, thanks.
That makes a ton of sense to me, but I was also thinking about the way that information spreads less formally, like outside of, you know, I work at Girls from Voting, something we talk about a lot is like what is sort of social capital that is shared maybe from a mentor or by a professor or your, you know, the difference between the prep you get at Stanford from CUNY, right? In terms of like just what's on the email list, sir? People are sending out like, hey, deadline for this, there you should apply, or like, it is so much less formal than what's necessarily taught in the classroom. And all these sort of secret whisper networks of what you should be doing to advance your career, in addition to the more formal benefits.
Yes.
Not so many people in practice, but just in general for influence. I also work in the industry, and I really that people have influence, and 80% of the participants were women. And I was thinking, like, why are we even showing up on this? And are we thinking that we're able to be able to influence, or are they constantly giving this feedback that we need to increase the influence? So, something definitely, I think, you know, as a woman, like, people may be struggling a little bit more to show this that influence.
Yeah.
I've definitely seen the trends where I work. So, I work for RBC Capital Markets, which is a big capital markets division in May, and I work specifically in tech. So what you see in that the the leaders within the tech department are their own men. And then we're trying to get more women. And the women we have are majority not the developers. We're a tech department, so majority developers. Most of the women, particularly the ones who are kind of in the leadership ranks, are the project managers and program managers who are paid less than the developers. I'm working with a firm, a recruiting firm, who hopefully will partner with us to get us new grads into the door. Now, it's great because they represent, they're very big on representing society. So they have their diversity metrics are aligned with society. It doesn't mean aligned with what you see like currently in the workforce. I have a lot of trouble figuring out how to bridge the gap between bringing all these like eager people in the door and then what we actually have in place and how you then see yourself moving up the chain. I think it's going to be, if we're able to get into program off the ground, I mean, there's going to be, it's going to be difficult.
Thank you. That's such a good way to talk about influence. I think maybe we can take one more. I saw it in the back.
No, I was just going to say, like, the team said earlier, that you have to change that culture. It's not good enough to bring them in because you have the bottom door. So if you're noticing the men are the tech leads and they have all the power and the women are playing these other roles, and you bring a group of eager, excited women who are technically savvy to do the work, they are going to be put in that opposition that they will be launching. So unless you put an intentionally plan a change in your culture, now speaking from firsthand experience of exactly what happened to me. As a Black woman going to an AT&T bell ass every day was told I didn't deserve to be there. The only reason I was there said I was Black, and they wanted their numbers and the affirmative action and diverse discrimination, and again. It didn't matter that I was tap dancing around in my corner. Right. And so until you change the culture in there, you're not in the service to people by bringing them in for the benefit of your company because you're caught the problem. Not you, but.
No, I agree. I love to get your ideas. Saying we're going to change the culture and actually put it in practice. My brain is not going. It's so hard to figure out what actually do.
Oh, yeah. And we should talk about some of the tools that are available to you as an NCWIT member. You know, we have an online decision support platform that's called the Tech Inclusion Journey that helps a team look at their current maturity, basically, with respect to DEI, and helps them prioritize what they want to work on. And it is designed to give you that structure and that framework for making change. It's a team-based tool because we know from research that people's primary experience is with their team. And so we've worked with companies to help them execute on the use of this tool within teams to build better cultures team by team within the organization.
Thanks. Did you have something?
Yes. Everybody has been sharing great things, and I want to make sure that the audience who is joining us online are able also to get your contributions. So when you make a comment, if you can just do it in like the loudest possible voice, that would be great. Thank you.
And we can also repeat up front too.
Yeah, so they could do that. I thought we were supposed to have a mic, but that's okay.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for sharing those stories. And we'll have more time, absolutely. And on session 3, we have some time to do some actual planning for your specific teams and how we might start with them to be some of these ideas. But now we want to think about moving beyond just the representation toward influential participation. And Terry's going to talk to us about why things are this way.
Thank you. All right. So let's talk about the cultures that we're all experiencing. And let's talk about the bias and the myth of meritocracy. We talked a little bit about it with Ms. Oluo in the plenary session, and she talked about how meritocracy is problematic. Let's dive in a little more deeply. Has anybody seen this picture before? This is a gem. This picture is from the creation of Computer Science Barbie. Okay, Computer Science Barbie is a good idea if you happen to want to inspire blonde, blue-eyed girls to join computing. Great.
However, they published a book written by a woman at the same time that Computer Science Barbie came out. And this is just a nice bit of in the book. "I'm only creating the design ideas," Barbie says, laughing. "I'll need Stevens and Brian's help to turn it into a real game." Barbie also gets a virus on her computer at one point in the book, and she has to get the boys to help her. I know this. Actually, I didn't know it. I can't see it. It's a good,
like,
great question. It's when she got 12, I think.
Yeah, 2011, those 12.
10 years ago.
Yeah, right.
Like, this seems like something you would have seen a very long time ago. Oh no, 10 years ago. The Social Science Advisory Board at NCWIT actually wrote a letter to Mattel in response to this book, telling them how horrifying it was. And it did get pulled. If you ever want a good laugh, there is a spoof book that somebody put out on this, which is full of all kinds of snarky things. That's pretty great.
What's it called?
I don't remember. We'll look it up. We'll make a note and we'll look it up for you. There are multiple kinds of bias that are reflected in our society. This is a picture out of O Magazine. This does not happen to little blonde girls like this girl in this picture, but it does happen to little brown girls in our culture all the time. So what causes this bias? Well, we all have schemas that help us make sense of the world, but sometimes they cause us to make mistakes. So an example of a schema that I like to give and how it can help us and why we have them is, imagine that you're driving in your car and you're driving down the highway and you see off to the side of the road a mall. You know, at first glance, what you saw, this collection of buildings and parking lots and cars, is a mall, because you have in your head a schema for what a mall is. If you didn't have a schema for what a mall was, every time you drove by a mall, you would go, "Oh, what is that collection of buildings and parking lots and cars?" And you drive and you'd see another one and you'd say, "Wow, what is that collection of buildings and parking lots and cars?" And your world would be very overwhelming. So we have schemas to help us interpret our world and help us understand our world quickly and repeatedly, but we make mistakes. What is your schema in your head for a leader? What is your schema in your head for a technical person? The good news is that schemas can be expanded. Once you meet a technical person who doesn't look like what's in your schema gets expanded. So let's play a game. This is a lung scan. Does anyone think there's anything unusual about this lung scan? I'm not a radiologist, so, but does anyone think there's anything unusual?
Yes.
I'd say, yeah. Yes? One's bigger than the other? What else?
All the white
firecrackers.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yep, the white bursts. What else might be problematic? Anybody? How about this gorilla? You don't see the gorilla because you're not looking for a gorilla. You're looking for nodules. You're looking for things that you see in lungs, but we don't see gorillas in the lungs. So this is an example of how we see what we're looking for. This was given to a whole bunch of radiology students, and also because I can't see my notes, I'm sorry. I don't have the exact number, but we'll get it for you. The number of radiology students who did not see this gorilla is somewhere in the neighborhood of 80 to 90%. Now, this is not designed to make you not want to go see radiologists. You should go because you probably don't have gorillas in your lungs. And if you happen to have some kind of nodule, they will see it because that is what they're. But we have to be careful. You look, you see what you're looking for. Am I, is it me still or is it you?
I can hop up. Yep.
Okay, come on up.
I'll come on up. All right, so all of this that we've been talking about really is power tilt, right? When there is an uneven distribution of power, often happening along the lines of gender, race, and other intersecting social identities. Sometimes it's age, sometimes it's socioeconomic background,
Sometimes it's just educational background. But the power tilt ensures that influence remains primarily with the majority group. And it maintains the status quo over time. Okay, so some things like, what is it like to experience a power tilt? It's easy enough to say, okay, there is this power differential. I think we all understand that. But what is it like? It means not having the ability to shape an agenda or to decide how your work is accomplished or not having your needs considered when making decisions, not having your contributions acknowledged when you do something. Not having them rewarded or recognized. So thinking about the very real consequences that power tilt has on people, it's not just that we're looking at charts and metrics, but that this is impacting people in their everyday life and how they are able to feel and experience success and happiness at work. So again, these are deriving from schemas, but also from microdynamics in local interactions. Really what that means is just who you're talking to every day. The minute that my daughter's bio teacher told her maybe she wasn't a good fit to be a biologist, that's a micro interaction that has influenced her. I've already heard her now 5 times tell me that she doesn't think that she's gonna do it anymore. She's been thinking maybe not biology, right? One micro little interaction can have a big snowball effect. And this is social power, right? It's not just happening between people, but structures that have been put in place over time to make some people fit in organizational spaces and some people not feel comfortable or not feel like they fit. I always, whenever I think about fit, I just cannot stop but thinking very literally when I was in graduate school and I was pregnant. And I was the only grad school, only grad student in my program pregnant. They told me to quit when they found out I was pregnant because they said the program was way too demanding and I would not be able to complete a PhD pregnant. I said, too bad, I'm already here and I'm already pregnant. So, but there were moments when I was sitting in class and I literally didn't fit, like the desk eventually would not fit over my growing stomach. And I thought, you know what? Because this desk was designed for somebody with a very different experience than what I'm having right now, right? So in that case, it was quite literally fit. But you also see this in engineering buildings when there are not women's bathrooms in most universities. So thinking about fit can be very literally to what the space is like, right? All temperatures tend to be set very cool because they're for men wearing 3-piece suits. So you've heard the stereotype about women always being cold at work. Oftentimes it's just about clothing and how we set that temperature for a specific kind of body to be in that space. So that's what I mean when I say like these big social dynamics. They're starting small, they're happening small to individuals, but they're cemented over time, stronger and stronger in structures. Okay, so this is a quote that we thought was helpful to kind of emphasize what it feels like to experience a power tilt. This woman said, when the guys spoke to me, they didn't expect me to have any ideas in their area of expertise. They would only look to me when it was something very specific to my function. Most of the time, they didn't really think that I would have anything to add in the broader discussions. Here's another one. For tech spaces developed by men, it seems like they didn't mind if they don't include me as much detail. But any technical spec I've seen created by a woman on my team has always had an immense level of detail. So you see, like, she's starting to get at the woman who said this, the differences between what's expected from certain people at work and that maybe the expectations aren't the same. So that's a power tilt, right? It can be so subtle. It can be so subtle and very difficult to identify. But anytime that there is some kind of disparity in terms of how people are expected to act, how they feel they can act in a certain space, is evidence that there is likely a power tilt happening. So one way we look at this is called prove it again bias. And you can see some of these measures, like when questions are addressed to somebody else. So let's say you're the expert in the room, somebody comes in and automatically asks somebody else the answer.
What's our negative caching for 404s in the CDN?
I think we have some extra participation happening online. So this happens more often, most often for women of color, but also happens for white women and men of color. It happens for everybody occasionally, but disproportionately happening for women of color in technical spaces, right? Where questions are addressed to somebody else, they feel like they can't make mistakes.
Like, how are we reading this? These numbers and writing these numbers?
So these are women, white women and women of color, all experiencing proven again bias.
Two out of how many times? Like, is it the same?
Well, what's the number? What's the x-axis?
I'm not sure what the x-axis is. I don't know if six was the highest on this one. But essentially it's how often they're experiencing or feeling like they have to prove it.
Is it the number of times that happens?
Or like on a radial scale.
I
think it's a scale. Yeah, but you can see it's happening overwhelmingly more often to women of color. Also happening to white women, right? That they're saying, this is an experience where I have to kind of prove it again, or my idea has been stolen, or there's less respect for my work, or this one's great, the last one, when people are surprised that you've done a great job. I'm not sure if anyone in here has experienced that, but that's part of prove it again bias. So it's just, I think the scale here is just showing like how much do people feel that this has been represented in their experience on a scale of maybe 1 to 6. I'm not certain on the original research, but I'm higher than that. Someone's promoted above you, right? Not treated as my role warrants.
How it manifests itself for me when I was a software engineer, and this was a while ago, but I bet it still happens, is the men would code, they would make their code so it kind of worked. And then the women would have to clean up their crap, fix their bugs, because they couldn't be bothered fixing their bugs.
Right.
That was like low level work.
Yeah. And there might have been more pressure to feel like you can't have bugs if you're feeling like your work is already being judged and that you're already having to prove it more than other employees. Yeah. Thanks for sharing.
A hierarchy of, because I think when I come to be that cleanup crew of quality, like those are the lower competent people, really, the cleanup crew. But obviously, that wasn't the case. It was just this bias that women.
Right. Yeah, thanks. So one other way that we talk about this is as tightrope bias. And I think this is kind of similar to what you're talking about, where there's this feeling that all women have, women of color reportedly have it much more than white women, that you are constantly kind of trying to balance, right? Being assertive, which you have to be in many careers, but being seen as aggressive. Right, expected to be a worker bee, maybe expected to be that cleanup crew is another way of saying that. Expecting to be passive. Women are expected to be deferent, right? And are oftentimes little girls are socialized to be deferent in most spaces. That's difficult when you're put into a leadership role or you're put into a role where you want to advance, and being deferent doesn't help with advancing and promotion, right? So it's this very difficult balance. Where you see women are interrupted more, their anger is perceived as problematic, where it tends to be that men's anger in organizational spaces is read as passion. For women, it's read as hysteria. And so it's just a very different reaction to the same emotion based on the bodies that we're situated in. Not expected to be a leader. Self-promotion is not rewarded. That's a tough one. And in fact, self-promotion is oftentimes listed as one of the characteristics that is one of the greatest causes in wage gap across occupations. Not that the work isn't as good, but that women just don't self-promote as much. Yeah, and then pressure to play a feminine role, which can be really problematic as well. Okay, so we're gonna talk about what we can do about this. And this was really the driving force behind the creation of the Powertilt tool. And so we have a little bit just about, and before we jump into the tool, we're curious to see how you're feeling about some of these statements. And I think there is an online poll to go for the folks joining us on Zoom. But we can just, in the room here, we can just raise your hand. Do you agree or disagree? Power is something we talk about explicitly in our organization. Is that true or not true for you?
How many agrees?
Okay. How many disagrees? Many more disagrees in the room here.
You're differentiating between how you talk about power in your team versus how you talk about power on like your full organization?
That's a good question. I don't think we specified, but I think that could be different.
Right.
Yeah.
I think those are very different.
Yeah.
So do you have conversations on your team?
Yes.
You do, but not as an organization.
Correct.
Interesting.
Yeah, not across teams.
But I'm
in higher ed, so academia is like a whole other like space.
Yeah.
But
so what about measuring diversity? When it comes to measuring diversity, does your organization primarily collect just headcount data? Or is it looking at influence?
Headcount.
Yeah.
Are there any hands raised for influence?
No hands raised.
How would they? Yeah, that'd be another way to measure count.
Yeah, we've talked about that a lot, and I'm curious what other people think in the room here too, but we've talked about title. Can you look at how many people have senior level titles within an influencer role? Patenting data was one of the ways that we chose to try to look at that. So things like that can be helpful.
For hiring, decision-making power.
Yep, decision-making power, budget control, those types of things.
Qualitative methods. To actually get feedback from people, whether it's been a focus group or a survey where they can also answer some open-ended questions. That takes a lot of extra work. Counting is easier. And speaking to today, you don't know the whole story if you don't determine the other thing.
Yeah.
Right. And I think some of that the rich data is coming from stories, from people's experiences. Yeah.
In our organization, we do talk about headcounts. They think that our team even wants to be, but I don't think we do anything about it. Like, just having a conversation with them and not do I'm sorry. So now I feel better about getting right to my package of this one. But I don't think we take any action on it, but it's just a conversation or dialogue.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe, Sarah, you could comment with people on Zoom that might not have been able to hear about the hypo.
Yeah, just that there's a focus on, like, we had a conversation, and so we did what we needed to do, DEI check, but it's not actually a meaningful conversation. It's just kind of looking at representation, it sounds like, for the most part over here, and then just doing a little bit of lip service to say, yes, we care about inclusivity without actually doing something about it.
Yvonne, are there any comments in the chat that anybody wants to share in this section?
Not right now.
Okay.
All right, well, I'm gonna move on so we can get to the power tilt, which is the tool designed to address some of these issues.
Oh, you'll have to click onto it probably.
Oh yeah, that's and lost power.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, so these were the research questions that the team used when they were developing the power tilt tool. Really, again, emphasizing how do power and influence operate within technical teams? So moving away from add women and stir and think more to what does it look like to have meaningful influence and participation? What makes somebody more influential or better able to influence team decisions? In the activity this morning, what made you listen to some people who were organizing the order in which you put your pages in the book, right? Some people stood up and were more willing to speak up, and others were willing to kind of step back and listen and observe and take direction. So some of this is personality. Some of it is linked with social identity and ways that we have been raised to perform in team building decision-making spaces. So we also asked, how is access to power and influence distributed among teams? So particularly in terms of gender, race, class, and age. And also, what are the implications for making more inclusive and innovative team cultures? right? We know there are good outcomes, but what are they? We really wanted in this research to gather some data from our partners using the tool to see what are the positive outcomes if you make your teams more inclusive and more hospitable. So we focus on teams specifically because most research on influences looks only at person to person, two person, and we wanted to see teams. You know that innovation is happening primarily from teams. There is not just, you know, one person kind of developing everything in a silo. On technical teams, it really is a team effort. So we wanted to take a look at that team dynamic. And teams can be greater than the sum of their individual members because of group process, but collaboration and deliberation, right? Having more ideas at the table has more positive outcomes. Okay, so I think we, in the name of time, should
go to the tool. This is gonna be exciting, especially if the Wi-Fi is still not working. can somebody test and see if the Wi-Fi is working? It's not? No?
Okay.
Well, perhaps you will want to use your phone then to do this.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so we did have people successfully do this on their phones this morning. If anybody doesn't have a phone that can do this, speak up and we'll find another way. But here is the short URL for you. Now, when you get to the question that asks you if you're doing a team or an individual, select team and put in this team right here, NCWIT-Summit.
You're having a QR code scan.
I know, I really should have. I'm sorry. It'll take you about 10 minutes to do it. And what we're going to do is let you all take it, and then we'll go over the results tomorrow.
So it asks what sector your team belongs to, but we're the team.
Oh, okay. So choose, think of a team in your own workplace and answer it for that team. Don't answer it for this group. And then what we'll do tomorrow is we'll look at how you all have different experiences on your home teams, right? So like maybe half of you will say, oh, my team's very hierarchical, and half of you will say, oh, my team's very flat. And we'll be able to compare the experiences you all are having back home to each other.
We should use that as our
use this for your team code, because tomorrow we'll have a dashboard that will show all your results on one dashboard.
So the
Okay. All right, so describe what sector your team belongs to, whatever your organization where you work is. So I'm going to pick nonprofit. Your type, technical or non-technical? Two teams, I'm going to go technical. Are you taking this part of a team? So say yes. And then you're going to put NCWIT-Summit. Okay. And then you're going to carry on.
Probably should have got on answer
first feeling. Yes, I can.
Okay, is this supposed to be anonymous?
It's anonymous, yeah.
That
if you put in age. Huh? You don't have to put in anything you don't want to put in. Everybody gets frustrated by the age question, I gotta say.
I don't know what there is. I used to survey.
You don't have things are
actually, the way the national is, you don't actually see what's in my age, so it won't.
But no, the reason I bring it up is because this one does one of the assignment and heard many, many times that we didn't see the way that. And particularly the ones that can sense in it. Right, he's pretty big and talk about something that they had jobs in the room and such.
What is? You don't get it.
Yeah, okay. So,
it's okay. I know.
Okay, so when you're finished with your survey, that's the last thing we're doing today. We'll look at the results tomorrow. So feel free to go to your connection with your other alliance members. The Yeah, it's called fireside chat on your badge. It's don't fool, there is no fire. But you can go meet up with people in your line. Yes, go to whichever one and match up with your
organization.
All right,
see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yeah.